A federal high court judge, Okunabang, revealed the two roles, the roles of two Nigerian banks played in the 2 billion naira pension fraud perpetrated by a former chairperson of the defunct Pension Reform Task Force, PRTT, Abdulrasheed Maina. It was also reported earlier that the judge sentenced Maina to 8 years imprisonment in his judgment at the end of a 2-year trial. Well, joining us to assess the journey so far is political analyst Biodun Shoumi. Thank you very much, Mr. Shoumi, for joining us.
It's my pleasure. Thank you for having me.
It almost seems to me that every time this issue is visited, pensioners have their blood boiling because, of course, this has to do with pensions. But looking at the story of Maina, starting from 2013, let's do a build-up. Up until today, before we start talking about, you know, his sentencing.
Well, the pension boss, the former pension boss, Abdulrasheed Maina, who is now convicted, has a very long history of trying to evade justice. From the moment when he was detected, there was also, almost a culture of impunity surrounding him. The authorities seems unwilling to move in to deal with him. Then we have his escapades, you know, running to Dubai, United Arab Emirates, only to be discovered. He later returned to Nigeria. There was an attempt to reintegrate him back, and that led to public outcry. He was forced to flee the country again. He ran to Nigeria, where he was finally caught and then, you know, sent back to Nigeria. Meanwhile, his son was also put on trial because of his culpability in the fraud which he perpetrated. But surprisingly, when Maina got to Nigeria, many people were expecting charges of 2.1 billion naira pension fund theft. The authorities, the prosecuting authorities, the Economic Financial Crimes Commission, preferred charges bordering on money laundering against Abdulrasheed Maina, and which carries maximum of 14 years in prison. You know, and it's quite very disturbing that for a man who stole billions of money, of pensioners' money, some of them have died in the process without being able to access their pension, only, you know, to be treated, you know, with levity. You know, you can imagine the situation where a man who was entrusted with public office, you know, to care for the most vulnerable people in our country, those who have served their country, you know, police officers who have served their country gallantly, only to be let down by the same officer and for the judge to impose 8 years out of the 14 years. That is very disturbing. The other disturbing aspects, you know, it's just the issue of the prosecution. Why? Money laundering charges, why not, you know, theft, you know, and, you know, the fraud, ensure that he stays a long time behind bars. And that's quite very important. In the case of the judge, his hands, the hands of the judge might be tied, given the fact that it's money laundering. But it is inexcusable to find an average sentence for him rather than a stiffer sentence. So I think the ESC should appeal that, while also preparing new charges of theft against Abdulrasheed Maina.
Now, you pointed out the issue of reluctance on the part of our government and, you know, the authorities in dealing with this issue. Let's not forget that at some point in the lifespan of this case, he was given a slap on the wrist at some point, which made him go to Dubai. So now that we at least have gotten some form of a sentencing, should we be expecting any more from the government? Because you're saying that the EFCC should be able to appeal. But if the government of the day or the system in itself doesn't feel the need to push further, why should the EFCC be trying to appeal to see if they can get more charges? Because, well, it looks like a case that he should have multiple charges on it.
Yes, well, I'm not even asking for appeal of the sentence, of the judgment, is appeal of the sentence, 8 years, that the Court of Appeal should be deemed that upward, given the gravity of the offense committed by him and the fact that he was in the occupying public office, which demands huge trust from him, and he did let them down. So That is the basis for acting for a review of the sentence, or not of the judgment. Then, yes, it is understandable that government seems to be very reluctant. At least that's the impression given, you know, to actually process him through the criminal justice system. Should that be the case, at least he's been convicted on money laundering charges, then the maximum penalty, you know, the stiffer penalty should apply. So because of that, one would not expect the state actors, you know, to try and prevent that from happening. They may even want to prevent new charges of theft being prepared against him. But at least for the one he has been convicted, he needs to get the due, you know, served, which he deserved of the law. And that is a fact. The other angle, again, which we should not forget, is the role of the banks. Mm-hmm. The banks themselves play a role in this problem. I am not advocating that we should sanction to the bank by closing them. You know, we cannot cut a nose in order to spite our face. We have thousands of people employed by these banks. What the government needs to do is to prosecute, you know, the executive directors responsible for those decisions and the staff responsible for it. Why would allow the bank to continue to function as normal, not to disrupt the economy? We can go to the extent of sanctioning the bank, fining them heavily as a corporate body, but individual officers responsible, you know, playing the role in the conniving or colluding or conspiring with the theft of public funds should be sanctioned heavily, processed through the criminal justice system. Let them account for the actions to a judge, and then let us see what the judge says.
I want to do a quick follow-up on what you're saying about banks and, you know, people being sanctioned. We do not have a system where, you know, there's a flagging of sorts when monies that are not supposed to, because a bank obviously knows how much money you would make, you know, how much money would come in. And even if they do not know, if monies are outrageously coming into an account, we do not have that system as opposed to outside of this country where they could flag it and investigate how these monies, the source of these monies. Yesterday, just to digress a bit, yesterday, Senator Alim Dume was urging the presidency to sign the wealth access, I can't remember exactly what it was, but he was asking that the government, the federal government put that in place. But we already have so many things that are similar to this in our constitution, but the problem is of obviously how we can enforce this. So it's not necessarily having laws in place, but do we enforce it? That's number one. Now, on the part of the pensioners, the people who have been at the receiving end of these particular fraud and this Maynas situation, do we have to wait for the state to do everything? What about these ex-pensioners filing a lawsuit? What about those who are not even ex, you know, workers, people who also are part of a pension scheme, the contributory scheme? Can't they also press charges of sorts to make sure that justice is done?
Yes, your question is twofold. But let me start with the last one, which is about the role of pensioners themselves. The way the pension system works is very clear. They will get paid. What happens is they will get paid eventually. Those who may not get paid are those who are currently working, you know, police officers currently, you know, serving, may end up in future not being paid. Because the way the pension system works is whatever money deductions is made now, is sent into the pension funds, and that money is used to pay, you know, the retired police officers. The question is, when it comes to those who are serving today, will they have the money there? Will the government be willing to step in to say, look, there's a shortage of pension cash, which is caused by Maynas? Will the government be willing to put that money up? That is the commitment which we are yet to have. The federal government needs to assure the pensioners that whatever has been lost due to the activities of Abdulrasheed Maynas will be.
Mr. Shoumi, I think that we've lost connection, but if you can hear me, you can go on. Can you hear me?
Yes. Okay. I can hear you now.
All right, go ahead.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Can you hear me? Yeah. What the pensioners would love to hear is that federal government giving a clear, unequivocal commitment that whatever shortage is arising as a result of Maynas action will be paid back to the pension fund by the federal government. That is very key. That will reassure the pensioners. you know, that event, and those who are in service, that wherever they retire, there will be money to cater for their pension needs in future. That's important. What's your second question?
Yes, I was talking about. Yes, I was talking about the Senator Dume's ask of the federal government.
Okay, about the laws. Yes, we already have laws. We have so many. You are correct. We have so many laws in place. What he wants to do is to, you know, further raise the bar for criminals, make it more difficult for people who acquire wealth, you know, without anybody being able to talk about their source of income, you know, to account for it. That is, currently, it is not illegal. If I have 1 billion naira in my account, as long as it's not a proceed of money laundering, as long as they cannot link it to any crime, then I can as well keep the money and enjoy. The reason is this, because the presumption of innocence is on the part of the accused person. The second reason for that is also whoever alleges must pay. So if I have a billion naira in my account, and you want to prove that I stole money or this money was gotten illegal, the burden is not on me to prove that I got the money legally. The burden is on you making the allegation to prove that I did not get the money properly. When it comes to the role of the bank, the same thing as it affects individual affects the bank. We as a nation should worry about the role of banks in our own economy. When you have a situation where banks, you know, would rather loan people at 30% interest rate, who wants to go into productive sector of the economy, and then eagerly and gleefully receive money stolen from our public wealth. You know, we should be worried about that. We should begin to ask questions. Why are banks charging 30%? How many people are borrowing? What is the percentage of cash which is not which are lushing? You know, they are in the banks, nobody's borrowing them. I remember about a year ago, the CBN was warning that they would sanction banks if they are not loaning people. But how many people would be willing, you know, to take a loan at 30%? What do you want to do if you take a loan of 100 million for a productive activity, maybe in the agricultural sector or in to build an industry? The first 30 million is interest in a year. You pay 30 million interest first without even repaying a dime of that loan. So what it means is, how much profit are you expecting will the economy generate in a way that you'll be able to pay the 30%? So therefore, the banks do not rely on loaning, which is a key function of banks, loaning money to the economy, to individuals engaged in the economy, because that is why they're keeping it at 30%. But they are eager and willing, they even lobby, you know, to receive money stolen from the economy, even when they know that there's no productivity that can justify it on the part of individuals, like a miner. So it's very worrying why we allow our economy to run in this way. So government should be forcing or getting the banks, you know, to come down to single digit interest rate while also, you know, cracking down on banks involved in this kind of process.
Okay.
Of looting the.
Well, this is something that, of course, needs to be discussed on a more public forum other than TV. But I want to say thank you. Byoto Showemi is a political analyst, and he's been talking with us. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
All right. Well, we'll take a quick break now to see what Nigerians have to say about the appropriate jail time for the pension fraud. And when we come back, I will give you just a little bit of my take.
Eight years is not enough. Think 20 years above. Yeah.
Okay, why?
Yeah, because, you know, pensioners, someone who has served the country for more than 30 years, if I'm right? Yeah, so someone has just come and stole the old pension. So what's left? There's nothing. So 8 years is just like 8 days.
Okay, if it's someone that I see that he's on the path of recovery, repentance, and all of that, 8 years might be sufficient. But if he's a die-hard person who's really hard not to crack, you could extend it.
To me, 8 years is not fair enough. I would have said maybe they take it to 15 to 20 years. Why? Because these people have worked hard for that money, and No, if you want a fair system, we should look into politicians taking money from pensioners' accounts and other schemes as such. So 8 years to me is not enough.
That's really small. You know, that's like stealing people's livelihood. You know, you work for so many years, save a lot of money, and you think that, okay, at this end of this year, I should be able to fend for myself, get my money, and somebody else now come and steal that. In fact, life imprisonment.
Not at all. That's not enough. If you have stolen a lot from the public, especially pension fund, something you are supposed to lay long when you retire from work, and somebody stole the money, then I'll be looking at, even life in prison is not bad. But sometimes you look at it from the two sides. What is the law saying? And what are we getting?
Well, here's my take. I really wonder half the time if we really are walking the talk when we say that we want things to change in this country. I ask because on one hand, we are asking for the head of the man who stole pensions money from people who have worked their whole life and start up money to be able to, you know, fall back on it. But then the banking systems, the banks are very happy, open to taking these monies without questioning where these monies are coming in from. And now, I'm very glad that the judge in this case had said that there is a moral decadence that is eating deep into the fabrics of the Nigerian system that we need to do away with. Because for once, we could not necessarily put a pin on this issue and say this is a fraud, a pensions fraud. Why are you hanging the man for money laundering? He stole money that was meant for pensioners. Let's leave that on one hand. Now, we're also looking at the system, the voting system. We're asking every single day that we want free, fair, and credible elections. But yet, the same people, the same Nigerians that are asking for good governance, that want Nigeria to change, are the same people who take monies from politicians and go to polling units to give 3,000, 2,000 to the voters and say, vote for this party, give me your card number. But you want a change. Have you asked that politician if he has what it takes to run for that office? And if he does have what it takes, then why is he not doing his groundwork and let the people who are voting decide who would win instead of trying to induce people? So whether we say the politicians are corrupt or Nigerians are corrupt, I think we're all part of the problem until we all start to ask ourselves the right questions as to if we really want change. And if you do want that change, then you need to start doing the right thing. In other words, you, that person that is a party agent, you, that person that is a foot soldier for that politician, you, that person who is a mother, father, friend, family member of these politicians who are corrupt and are giving out monies to people to induce them to vote, you're part of the problem. Until you stop, we will not have the kind of Nigeria that we deserve. I am Mary Anacol. Have a good morning, a good evening.